This is the iTIG model B. The B model includes milli-ohm winding resistance, Megohm or insulation resistance, DC Hipot, surge test, and it has an onboard database with reporting software. Optional features include advanced multi-coil software and reporting, capacitance, inductance, and impedance, as well as the RIC test, rotor influence check, and partial discharge. The Mi model here is a 12 kV version. It has four high voltage leads, so three red plus one black ground lead. It also has the low voltage lead set. The low voltage lead set is used for the resistance measurement as well as the capacitance, inductance, and impedance measurement, while all other measurements and tests are done on the high voltage leads. In this demonstration, we are going to test this 460 volt concentric ground three-phase stator. We know that since it's concentric ground, we will have some interesting results in the surge waveforms, but knowing that going into the test, we have a couple of ways to qualify whether the insulation system is good or bad. So, first step here is on the instrument, you click start. We see the customer directory or motor database. I have already entered in our motor in the database, so we click the line or row containing our serial number right here. We now get the motor information, nameplate information, and so on. As you can see, we already have most of the information typed in, including the job number. We will say test. We are now in test mode, and we'll work our way from left to right along the tabs in the bottom of the screen. We're actually now on the last tab here, the test summary screen. This is where we will get the pass-fail recommendations at the end of the test set. There are three optional fields here that are very nice to use from a reporting perspective. Test description field, just a quick word identifying what you are testing on, in this case a stator as opposed to an assembled motor, for example. Test stage to identify where you are in the service process, for example. I'm going to use an incoming used version here. And the operator. I like to use my initials. Next step here is the setup screen. At the top of the screen, you see the Hipot and surge test voltage formula. The default in the instrument is 2 times the operating voltage plus 1000. In this case, that ends up being 1920. If you don't like the formula or you don't like the final test voltage, you can always click any of the white fields and change the test voltage. Let's say, for example, that we want to do the surge test to 2000 in this case. Click the field, type in your voltage, hit enter. If you want to change it back, hit any of the white fields and just click enter and it will default back to using the formula. Next step here is to enter in the humidity. So that will be the air humidity. We're in Colorado, nice dry day, 30% give or take. Next is the winding temperature. Note that this is the winding temperature, not necessarily the ambient temperature. So using an IR gun, for example, to figure out what the temperature of the winding is very important here. We use that to determine or correct the winding resistance measurement as well as the Megohm measurement. If the motor has been sitting in your workshop or in storage, you can assume it's at ambient temperature, but in many other cases, it will be warmer or maybe colder. Next up here, a limit setup. On the right-hand side, you see the pass-fail criteria for the resistance measurement, the Megohm measurement, and the surge test. I'm just going to leave these at the defaults. If you have any questions about how we set these defaults or if you want to use other defaults, contact us. So we are now ready. We have the motor in the database. We have the test sets and pass-fail criteria defined. We are essentially ready to start our test. So first up, we're going to start with the resistance measurement. So we have our low voltage lead set, again, labeled 1, 2, and 3 for phase 1, 2, and 3. We connect clip 1 to phase 1, clip 2 to phase 2, and 3 to 3, like so. And now we're back on the tester. We select the second tab from the left, so our resistance tab. we can now either do the measurements manually and look at 1 to 2, 2 to 3, 3 to 1, or you can click the start coil symbol and it will run through and make the measurements in the three phases and then calculate the max delta R, or the balance. We set our balance limit to 3%, so as long as we're less than 3, which we are, then we have passed this first test. Next up is the Megohm measurements. So now we have to replace the leads. So disconnect our low voltage lead sets and set that aside and find our high voltage lead set. So first, ground lead, very important to connect for this measurement. Otherwise, you're not going to get any leakage current. And then lead 1, 2, and 3. Again, 1, 2, and 3 to phase 1, 2, and 3. Like so. So now that we have our leads connected and nobody's touching this, including myself, then we're safe to start the test set. We have a couple of features in both Megohm and Hipot that we'll cover here. One is the stop after 1 minute. I'm going to check that off. That means we can let the test set run for a minute and then it will automatically shut off the test set. So again, we're connected, ready to start the test. You hit the red button, click it once, and it will say high voltage is on. To increase the test voltage, you use the slider on the right-hand side. If you do 3 full swipes all the way up, we will get to our test voltage here that is set to 1,000 volts in this case. You can always go up and you can go down if you decide to do so. I'm going to try to hit 500 volts actually in this case. Like so. And now we can let it sit there for the full minute. And in this case, it will calculate the dielectric absorption ratio for you as well, automatically. If you don't check the stop after 1 minute and you let it sit there for a full 10 minutes, then you'll get the PI, polarization index. There's also an option here to do what we call a slow ramp. So we will cover that in the DC test here shortly. So take a look at the counter, the time. We're now approaching a minute, and when we hit the minute, it will automatically discharge the windings and report our dielectric absorption ratio. So we have applied 500 volts, measured the leakage current, very low leakage current, and then it calculates the megohms for you, and then the corrected value at 4 degrees Celsius. Obviously much higher than what we set as our pass-fail limit, which was in this case 5 megohm. Installation system is dry and clean. We're okay to proceed to high voltage. Leave the leads connected the way they were. Click Hipot. We're now in DC Hipot mode. Again, you have the stop after 1 minute feature, which I'm gonna leave checked off for now. Hit the red button, high voltage on. This time I'm gonna use the slow ramp feature. So click slow ramp, and then you'll see it says, in this case, 20 volts per second. Click play, and it will now ramp at a steady rate of 20 volts per second. If I hit the up arrow, I can change that to be 40, 75, 100, and so on. If you want to stop at any time, hit the pause button, and then it stops the ramp cycle. Click play again, and it continues to ramp. Pause, turn off slow ramp, and you're back to being able to use the slider the regular way. We set the design test voltage to 1920, so that means if we ramp all the way up as fast as we can, we're never going to exceed our test voltage that we've defined already. If you want to go higher, then set your target voltage higher and then repeat the test. So it's going to sit here for another few seconds and then automatically shut off. There we go. Sat there for a minute, measured the leakage current. Obviously no arcs or no excessive leakage current, so we are safe to proceed. Next up here is our surge test. This probably looks familiar. It's the oscilloscope screen. The nice thing about modern test equipment is that you don't have to set either the time base or the voltage scale. You tell it what voltage to go to, which lead to energize, and then you click the button. Lead 1 is selected. We arm the instrument, press the red button, it will automatically make all the oscilloscope adjustments and then drive the voltage to 1920 volts. And then we do the same thing. Lead two, arm the instrument, red button. Lead two, done. Three, arm the instrument, red button. And now we have the line-to-line comparison or the surge comparison for phase one, two, and three. As you can see, they don't quite overlap, and that's as to be expected since we are testing a concentric ground application. We have a way to still qualify if this is a good or bad insulation system, and we will include that here very quickly for the fun. So pulse to pulse, I went back to phase one to start over, arm the instruments. It's gonna ask me if I want to override. I say yes, because we want to repeat this test. So now it's going to do the pulse to pulse surge test. So we start at the very low voltage, about 100 volts, and we increase the surge voltage in 25 volt increments. So 100, 125, 150, 175, so on and so forth, all the way up to 1920. So we calculate the difference between the curves at each voltage step for each individual phase. So now we're looking at each individual phase throughout the voltage range as opposed to comparing the three. So let's see what that looks like. Phase one, ramping up the voltage, we are done. Phase two, again, we want to override, yes, go. It's very fast. And phase three, override, yes, hit the red button. So now we've repeated the surge test and we still get our line-to-line comparisons, but we are now using the pulse-to-pulse results in the right-hand column as the pass-fail criteria. So as you can tell, we are getting very nice and low percentages, about 5%, 5 to 6%, which is great. That means that the insulation didn't break down as we increased the test voltage. So last tab over, this motor tests fine, all pass. We're happy, we're done with the test set. You hit the folder button. Everything is automatically stored. There's no save operation. We can now click view test, view print pass test. And we now see the time and date stamp, including the test description, test stage, and job number. So as you can tell, it's very nice to include these three small pieces of information from a reporting perspective, and also for finding where you are or where you were in the test process. We can say display test, and we can go back and we can look at the exact same screens that we were just on. Or we can say print report. You get some options to include the pulse-to-pulse charge, for example, or other features depending on what kind of test you've done. Let's say we want to include those, say print. This report is now stored as a pre-formatted PDF. Can include your company logo, for example, on the instrument. At the end of the day, when you're done with your testing or you need to get that report to the customer, you can either use a USB flash drive. So you would folder all the way out to your customer directory, sync files to flash drive, you would get all your raw data files, including any printed reports on the flash drive. Stick that in your computer, open TR Pro, which is supplied at no extra cost with the instrument, upload all the data, and there you go. You also have the option to add Wi-Fi or Ethernet to this instrument if you want to sync your data that way.